Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're doing some spring fishing on the Lower Columbia River just below Bonneville Dam for both Chinook salmon and American shad. Now today's episode is highly instructional, so if you want to learn to be a better river fisherman, stay tuned.
I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television.
Due to lower than usual catch rates early in the spring, the Lower Columbia River Chinook salmon season has been extended. So we're running up to an area in the Columbia River Gorge, just below Bonneville Dam and near Beacon Rock, known as the Shad Rack, with guide Steve Leonard. And Steve Lynch of Procure, along with his two boys, James and Jake. In a few weeks, the Shad Rack will be swarming with shad, but now it's salmon time.
Hey, this is a Brad's killer fish wrapped in a sardine fillet, and all I'm doing is putting the sardine bait sauce on it, which is just nothing but chunks of sardine ground up. So as it's out there working, it's just gonna ooh and goo and drip pieces of sardine off, put a ton of scent in the water very quickly. We're only doing one of these out of the boat, so I'll put money on it. This will be the first rod going down.
What we have here is we're running some Brad's killer fish, and we're wrapping them with a sardine fillet, and I've taken them last night and I filleted them all out, cut them into the sections, sizes that I need. And then I put some Slamola powder and some Monster Bite from Procure on there just to get the bite stimulant. These fish are 140 miles from the ocean, so they're usually craving salt, and they like a hotter bite or bait at that time instead of a sweet bait. So this really kind of makes it a little bit hotter and spices it up.
Okay, when the fish are first coming in the bays, they're trying to purge themselves of the salt. So they're looking for a sweeter cure or a sweeter sense. But as they get further upstream, they need the salt, so they're actually looking for a saltier scent. So we're up here right below Bonneville, so we're still affected by the tide, but we're far enough up that you really want to go heavy on the salts. He's not there. Oh, yeah, he is. Yeah, he's there. He's a 2-pounder.
Is it?
No, I don't feel much weight. Oh yeah.
That's a jack.
My boy on the net. Come on, grab the other rod, ladies.
No, it's good. Leave it out. We don't need to reel it up for this little dinky fish.
Yeah.
Come on.
He's definitely a big fish, huh?
You got these guys' line. You
I
can't
know.
Control a 2-foot fish.
I tell you what, that's how I am.
Jerry's the rod tip. Don't reel no more.
Half yours, buddy.
Half yours.
Yeah.
You take 12, you take 12.
I'll take the middle, I'll give you the head and the tail. Woo, daddy.
All right, what we have here is a jack Chinook salmon. Jack is under 24 inches in size and length. They usually come in towards the end of the run, and the nature of it is that they come in and spawn or fertilize the eggs. They're all males typically, so they come in and help spawn out the, fertilize the eggs, so there's always a reproduction of salmon when they come in or when they go to spawn. So you're allowed 5 or up to 6, no more than 1 adult Chinook per day over 24 inches. So you can have 5 of these jacks plus 1 adult for a 6 fish limit for the day.
This is the lure that we caught the fish on. It's a Brad killer fish. You know, and this blue pirate with the chartreuse tip seems to be the hot color. The cool thing about these Brad's killer fish is you can fish them right out of the package. You don't have to tune them for the most part. You don't have to change the hooks. But these things will run true time and time again, even after you catch a fish. So, but you always want to still check it and test it. But this one, we tested it, it runs true even after that fish.
Fish on with that one. Let me cut loose in the anchor up there, Jake.
It's either swimming at us or it came off, one of the two.
Keep going.
Okay, we got a better fish on here right now. We got a lot of current running below Bonneville Dam here, so we kind of loosen the anchor and we chase the fish so we don't have to fight the current.
Straight up. Maybe not ready.
Here in the Columbia, we have hatchery fish and we have wild fish. They have a fin on them. It's an adipose fin. And this fin right here should be missing right here if it's a hatchery fish. This is a wild fish. Means that we need to let it go. So we're going to get the hooks out of it and get a good safe release and let it take off. So good fight, some good action, but unfortunately we need to let this one go.
Welcome back to the Columbia River. I'm Justin Wolf. So far, we've hooked and landed a good eating jack chinook, plus netted a beautiful adult wild chinook that must be released.
Yeah, this is a wild fish, so we don't get them out of the water. We just take the hooks out when they're next to the boat in the net, release them, and let them go on their merry way.
You still there?
He's there.
Get it going? Cut loose from the anchor. Got another one on here. There's a number four, I believe. Oh, it's a monster.
Something's coming around and we stop.
Looks like we got another jack here. Let's see what we got here. Good eaters right there.
Yeah. Oh, it's a wild.
No, it's not.
No, just kidding. Yeah, this is a killer fish that we just got the fish on. And what I normally do is we'll wrap four of these the night before, soak them in the sardine bait sauce. But this particular plug was wrapped, and it was only soaking for about 15 minutes. I put it out, and it wasn't 3 minutes before it just buried down.
All right, today, this has been one of the hotter rods today for us so far. We've got three fish on this rod. Sometimes it has to do with it's the right leader length, or a lot of it has to do here is because it's in the right spot for the depth of the water where these fish are running, or it could be a drop-off spot where that particular rod's at. I'm trying to run them all at the same spot, but this one seems to be more catching fish than the other ones are. Sometimes it could be the right action to lure, that particular lure is just more of a fish catcher than all the other ones that you're using. So when I get the Brad's killer fish, when it's a fish catching lure, which most of them all are, but when they are, I put them in a separate box. I'll actually kind of mark the bill on them, how many fish they've caught. This is a new lure yesterday. It's got five so far today, and I just kind of keep track so I know that it's a fish catching lure. So when the client gets in the boat, that I know that he has a really good chance of catching a fish. On the gear that we have today, we have a braided line. It's a 50-pound braided line. Very simple setup here with a slider. I use a swivel for the lead slider, and then I run a couple like 8-millimeter beads and a 6 in here, and then a bead chain. The bead chain just helps with any twist. We don't have any twists running any plug like this, but if you want to switch over to a prawn spinner or a hard spinner, then you have a lot of spinning going, and you want that bead chain in there to take up for the twist and the line on that. Then we have a 30-pound test monofilament leader here. It's a 52-inch leader. These fish are not leader shy up here. We're fishing, you know, with a lot of current. We have sea lions up in this area, so we don't really want to go with any fluorocarbon or any light leader because of the fact you have a chance of losing that plug, which is the fish catching plug, or lose your fish. So 30-pound leader, you can do a 40 if you want it, but I recommend nothing less than 30. And then we have a dropper. Your dropper lead can depend on any size from 12 inches to usually 24 in here. Some guys will run them shorter. This is a 24-inch dropper. And I'm running a green line on here, just a high-vis green on my lead line, just so I know that my lead line is the lead line. If it gets tangled up in the net, I need to cut a line. I know I'm cutting the right line, not the clear line with the plug on it and losing the fish. Another reason why I run the slider right here is only, it doesn't catch more fish, but if I make a mistake and get the weight in the net when I go to net your fish, at least the fish can run and take line with the slider, and I can cut the lead line and get a second chance to net that fish back in the boat. So it works very well for that. Other than that, you don't need to really have a slider, but it gives us a second chance if we need it. This rod here is a Lamiglas rod. It's the XCC 803. It is a very sweet plug-in rod. It's the 803 8-foot, 12 to 30 pound test rated rod, and it's a really good rod for fishing spinners or quick fish up here or anywhere you're going to be fishing this rod for that application. So it works very well with that, with the graphite handle, very clean looking rod, and a lifetime warranty, so highly recommended.
I just backed this out with the sardine bait sauce, and I just buried right down. So hopefully this little bigger fish that we've been catching this morning, but at least it's been solid action, so no complaints.
Okay, get the other rod.
Oh, still up angle?
Yeah. The wild fish.
It's a go back. You can sure tell the difference between the wild and the happy. The wilds come right up and jump.
They got a lot more action to them.
It's early June, which is typically the height of the Columbia River Shad Run, which usually numbers in the millions. Today, we're with Jason Hambly and Tim Cook of Lamiglas, who are taking their two boys, Connor and Colby, on a shad fishing adventure just below Bonneville Dam and next to Beacon Rock.
Today, the conditions for shad fishing are pretty good. The river's running pretty high and kind of pushes those fish in towards the banks a little more. And right here, we're going to be anchoring along these pilings, and it just kind of seems to funnel the fish right up along this shoreline, and we're just going to anchor up and see what we can get going on.
Are you ready? Drop it?
Yep. We're going to be running these little wedding ring shad lures. These are on two rods. We're going to also run two rods with chartreuse grubs with chartreuse head. Anything with chartreuse or red or pink, and this combination of silver works really well for shad. So when shad fishing, a lot of the shad are plankton feeders, so a lot of times I'll run shrimp or krill scent as an additive. It kind of helps stimulate the bite a little bit. So just like as a lot of people will run for salmon, is all I run is a sliding setup. I'll run a bead here, and that's more or less to save the ceramics and the inserts of the rod tip. Helps protect against that on the tip. And then a sliding lead setup with another bead here, and then a swivel to about 4 feet, 5 feet a leader to your lure. And then just run about a 3 foot dropper to 5 ounces of lead. Just snap it on there and good to go. The rod I'm running today is the Lamiglas Kenai Quick, or Kenai Series. It's the XCC 801GH. These are a great all-purpose rod for steelhead. Some guys will run them for trolling for trout. They work really well for shad. They're made of a blend of fiberglass and graphite. Gives them a little softer action. Allows the fish to hold on a little better. You don't tear as many hooks out. And allows your plugs to work more freely. They're just a great all-purpose rod. These are pretty much your standard go-to deal for shad. A lot of guys will run these in the Willamette as well as the Columbia River here. It's just a chartreuse-headed Oregon tackle lead head with a gold hook and a chartreuse grub. The gold hook seems to help quite a bit for some reason. We might have to let out a little bit of rope. I think we're up a little far. Now hold it like this.
Reel there.
Lift up. Pretty cool, huh? Let's tighten the drag a little. Okay. Oh, big female. This shad is a big female. They generally run a little larger in size. And pick that one up on the little smiley blade. Good job, bud. Wanna let it go?
Sure.
All right. This green tiger is a great color. It just works well for shad. It's good old standby.
Yeah.
Mack's lures, they're the hot ticket. This little male here.
You wanna let it go, Colby?
Yep.
All right.
There it goes. Two fish so far, and they're both on the little Mack's lure. When you're putting the super gel on, you want to be sure you just put it on the beads. The problem, if you get it up on the smiley blade, it has a tendency to gum it up and it doesn't spin as freely. So as long as you got it on there, it don't matter where it's located.
Welcome back to the Lower Columbia River. I'm Justin Wolf.
Get it, bud.
Jason Hambly and Tim Cook from Lamiglas have their two boys on a shad fishing adventure that's just starting to heat up.
This one's huge.
Okay, good.
Smiley blade strikes again.
All right.
Just to be a little different on one rod, I'm gonna rig it up with a Brad's Magnum diver here. Again, run about about 4 to 5 feet of P-line fluorocarbon, and then tie on a little grub. When you're rigging these, you want to run the tail down because then it allows that little grub tail to spin there. All you do is just thread it on the little gold head here and...
Got one there. Get it, Colby. There you go. All right. We're releasing all the shad today, but guys can, some people eat them and some people just keep them to smoke up or use them for sturgeon bait. There's a number of things you can do with them, but it's a great fun deal for the kids and they have a ball fighting them, so. In there, step back and I'll grab it for you. Another big female.
Looks like the same one.
A lot of fun. Good job, dude. All right.
I know there was 85,000 over the dam yesterday, and I would imagine it's probably going to be exceeding 100,000 here in the next day or two, so a lot of fish.
All right, bud.
What kind? Shad?
Yep.
We're gonna go on the other side of the island over towards the shad rack now. It's on south of here, so go see if we can't get into a little more action there.
So where we're gonna be fishing now is gonna be the shad rack. It's an area, it's just a big gravel bar here in the Columbia River. It's right off of the main channel on the Washington side. The reason why we're fishing here is the current is correct. The depth is perfect for shad. That's kind of why they call it the shad rack. It's the most popular area on the Columbia River to fish for shad. So we just back bounced the rods out. Before we could even put it in the holder, we got one. I think we're in a better spot now. We should be able to get them pretty good. Connor.
Connor.
There you go. time, two at a time, two at a time. Thank you.
Oh, that's a monster. Get him. Get him. He's on there.
Fish on.
We could use a net and have a little better hook to land ratio, but we choose not to just because it's just becomes more of a hindrance when you're pulling the fish in and your gear gets tangled in the net. So that's why we run. We just grab them by hand and pull them in. So you're almost there. Okay, swing it back up and swing it over. Oh, geez. Chaos.
So many.
Oh, that one's
got one, too.
Oh, no.
Oh, you're trampling the animal.
Hang on, partner. Hang on.
Yeah. That one ain't gone.
We got a quadruple.
Okay, thanks for watching today's episode of Angler West TV. You know, it's only with the sponsor support that the show is made possible, so please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.